So, welcome all to this August gathering.
I'm absolutely honored to have
Gopal Krishna Ramaswamy,
who has been instantly
a very good friend,
and
I've been collaborating with him very recently
on a couple of occasions
across two projects.
And we have been exchanging emails over the last,
eight years ever since I was in Denmark, and then ever since I moved back to India.
Gopi needs no mention.
He is an undergraduate from University of Agricultural Sciences, and then obtained his PhD from NCBS.
And after finishing his PhD,
he has had illustrious experience working for University of Yale, Tennessee, and two other universities before he took up industrial experience working for Thermo Fisher.
And then
he steadfastly moved towards working for Genotypic as one of the directors.
And then he
established his own firm called Theratools 3.5 years ago. Where he was working towards nanospin 360 degrees, which is
a wonderful panel in making.
And has got several other panels that are vividly used
not only for
validation of next generation sequencing technologies,
but
this company has also been providing services for various molecular biology tools, those including the next generation sequencing services.
But if you really look back,
I can firmly say that Gopi is probably
the only one expert in India
who can speak a lot about technologies, including the single cell transcriptomics.
So we are quite honored today.
I'm absolutely overwhelmed and thank Gopi for having given his time today. Thank you so much, Gopi.
So without wasting time, we'll have Gopi's 15-minute presentation today.
And then that will be followed by about one hour Q&A session.
Thank you so much. Gopi, please.
Sure. Sibal, thank you, Prashant. Thanks for having me in this cyber session meeting. So it's glad to be here, and then I'd be happy to discuss some of the stuff. Before that, anyway, you have already quite a bit updated. Thanks for that introduction. But I'm going to tell why I did whatever I have done at this point. So that's a kind of a journey so far. And probably we can look at your question and answers and how I can answer those things. So I'm just presenting my presentation. So yeah. Can you guys see my presentation?
Yes, very much.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, the talk of the title of my talk is my journey so far. Because I thought till this point, whatever I have done, I think there are a lot of people, even certain discussion when we were having the genomics BioClues, you also pointed out certain things like students, sometimes they will be, they would like to know what type of direction they have to take, what if they do this. How does it work? These kind of things, questions are always there. So I thought, let me tell my experience, what I have done and what presently I'm doing kind of thing, so that will help others to think and ponder over what they can do with their knowledge and what they can contribute to the whole world. Again, thank you, Prashant, for having me here. And this is fantastic. So all of us, we know that as a when you are born, and then probably till your death, you have kind of four stages of life you go through. So kind of like first will be more like you study a lot and then learn a lot. Then you start applying it different time points, different phases of your life. So just to tell you that I'm in the age of this one, 26 to 50 years. Basically, I'm in the second phase of the whole life. Obviously, we don't know whether every one of us will go through the one of us that sannyasa or not. But at least we have plans as a family to start something, form, and then stay there for calmly after we retire. So that, at least that plan we have. But ultimately, what I have seen is the two phases of my life where I have kind of studied and then learned, enjoyed learning whatever I have learned, and then how I started applying that, and then how it has helped me to come to this stage. So that's what I'm going to tell, a couple of stages in my life. So a lot of times, if you ask anyone, like this is a kind of a philosophical question as well as subjective question. So a lot of times we start thinking, when especially when you start studying science, you start asking these questions. So, but just to explain where I have come from, what I have done, this kind of thing. So just I thought I'll just bring that one slide here. I was born in Mysore. It's a Karnataka state in India. It's south of Karnataka, where it's a calm place, and then people are really nice. In fact, I feel very bored when I go to Mysore a lot of the time. So from there, under my primary as well as high school and college, I did it in Mysore. My primary school picture I couldn't get. It's a local vernacular Kannada language medium. That's where I studied till 7th standard. And then 8th standard, I went to a school called Marimala Pass High School. But it's a pretty decent school. In fact, in our batch, the guy who got first rank, he came from this school, so Marimala Pass High School. So it's a good school in principle. So then I moved to, after 10th standard, I moved to Sharda Vyas College. So that's where I did my QC. Just to give a glimpse of like how the colleges are, how the schools are, just I've shown you the picture there. So when I was finishing my undergrad and second PUC, there were a lot of choices, but I was kind of a pretty average score. Though the potentials were there, a lot of the time we don't have attention, because either we don't have interest or our friend circle would be such that we don't really put enough effort. So there is always an option to go to medical, engineering, these kind of things. But both the things I was getting pretty far from my source, so I avoided going anywhere. Had an option to come to, I got a chance to come to University of Agriculture Sciences in Bangalore. So that also helped me to come out of my nutshell, like the, well, whatever you call, otherwise you will be the home throughout your life. If you don't go out of your thing for college studies. So I ended up coming to Bangalore. That was a kind of really adventure for me, because stayed in hostel and other things, but it was the most wonderful experience I ever had in my life. So first 4 years, it was an undergrad education at University of Agriculture Sciences. It's a fantastic campus. It's a fantastic library we have. So you can spend 24 hours wherever you want in this campus. So that is the way it used to be, at least. Now probably some restrictions are there. So there I did my BSc Agri, and then MSc Agri. Then again, since we had fellowship to continue as a CSIR, I had an option to do a PhD, combining both UAS as well as the NCBS. The NCBS was just being built at that place, and then it was just getting inaugurated around like 2009-2010. So collaboration between Professor Uday Kumar and then Professor Matthew, that led me to do my PhD research work in the NCBS and then also field work in the US. Having said that, I had got option to join Indian Institute of Science, but I denied that joining to department where I got my admission. Because I thought it's being a new institute, then we'll get a fantastic opportunity to interact with the faculty season, learn more from the faculty. So that's where I decided to stay between the US and then NCBS and do my PhD. So PhD was more on the molecular biology. So once you start, since I had interest in the molecular biology, I took the plant molecular biology things. So I'll connect where the interest comes from and then how I wanted to do whatever I'm doing presently. So this is till the 2001 or 2002. That's the time I finished my PhD and then started doing certain other things, advanced studies. So if you look at it, I mentioned that's the 4 years of the period I enjoyed more. So what do I enjoy? So in fact, agriculture is such a thing. Every 3 months you used to have some three tests. Tests are used to be like kind of fun for us. I just read 2-3 hours and then go and write whatever you know, then you get some CGPA, a decent CGPA you get. So if you are alert in the class, you can do average score, you can do always. That helped me to spend my time in the library and then read a lot of books. One of the things which I really enjoy, I adopted in my throughout my life is there are a lot of the names George Bernard Shaw has said, like there are those who look at things the way they are and ask why. I dream at things and never were and ask why. So this is the kind of a context which I'm bringing certain concept. Because I do feel more of a, I'm not an experimental scientist, I'm more of a thought scientist rather than the experimental scientist. So I would enjoy reading more and then learning things and then imagining things, what is happening rather than just doing the things. So that also kind of a deterrent for my experimental biology in the future, my postdoctoral studies. So that also led to me an interesting concept, because a lot of the times people ask me, you are doing plant molecular biology or agriculture, how come you move to the different things? It is the reason is we were reading quite a bit about the molecular biology and then RNA was an important topic at the point. During my undergrad around 93-94, when I was reading certain concepts, we thought, in fact, I wrote a small hypothesis kind of article where, if at all, if an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, if it is living in a eukaryotic cell, what kind of benefit it could have in the cell? Why it should be there rather than not having that? So why not an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase be in the eukaryotic cells? Because I found it's very interesting, because RNA could be duplicated without any transcription being there. Then also edited RNA molecules could be amplified without much problem. So all these things were kind of fantastic things were there. And then also I was trying getting some clues from the earlier papers from the viral RNA dependent RNA polymerase. There are people used to find cellular RNA dependent RNA polymerase activity, but they were never able to prove or they were not able to do anything at that point. So especially in the plants, it used to be there, because there was always a thinking that it is an artifact in the plant, because virus is all kind of producing these enzymes. So that initially when I sent to certain many places this paper, it got rejected everywhere. When the RNA I kind of discovered, some people encouraged me, especially there are a couple of people, one in the same and then Kakuli. So they encouraged me to re-submit this paper to the current science. So that came as a hypothesis paper. So still I'm kind of happy with the way I was thinking of them. We do still think there might be a molecular, there could be a kind of a modification should be there for the molecular, central dogma of molecular biology with this enzyme. So that is what led to me to go to the area which I kind of moved to postdoctoral studies. So for then after my PhD, when I was doing my PhD, just it's an interesting thing. So a lot of the times we leave things and then just move on the stuff. So I had cloned a lot of genes from the stress responsive genes. One I had got it published, and then hundreds of there, which people had I had to do certain work, or somebody had to do continue the thing. So as soon as you get what you want, or an developer, basically army, I got an option to work in US. So that's how I, as soon as I applied to this Professor Verma Henry, he was from the Gerard Hurwitz lab where T4 RNA ligase was discovered. He saw my paper, and then he was extremely happy, and he took me to as a postdoctoral studies for his thing. So he was a young faculty in the UConn Health Center. When I was doing the setting up the RNA biochemistry, so I learned a lot from Henry, because biochemistry is the one which teaches how to do the experimental studies, which a lot of the times in India we miss as a molecular biologist. So we try to do certain things, but being with Professor Matthew, I learned quite a bit of the how to set up the controls and assist and other things. But if you do the real biochemistry, that's where you learn exactly what the assays have to be set up and all those things. So that helped me to look at things differently. Though I was there 1 year, I learned a lot of things from him. And then, but during that time, I got an opportunity in the same Connecticut Yale University, in the same state. Professor Frank Slack, he's the co-discoverer of LEAD-7 microRNA. I got an opportunity to work with a fantastic person. His lab was the genetics lab. Cell biology and genetics lab, but I got an independent option to look at the mechanism of mRNA action in CNS. So that's how I moved towards the molecular biology and the mRNA mechanism from the plant. So when I was finishing my postdoctoral studies there, so though I had a H-1B visa, but I wanted to come back to India, because that's what we had decided, my family and myself. Just we will go and see outside and then come back and then set up something or contribute something to India. That's what our aim always is. So then when I wanted to come back, I was looking at opportunities to come back. I came and then interviewed at certain institutes and other places, but obviously it was not so easy to get the institute assistant professor at that point. Opportunities were less. But I got a chance to work in the in vitro gen, because they were just trying to set up the company here. It was called In Vitro Gen Bioservices India Private Limited. I was a kind of a first employee there, other than expat who came from US. He was the director of In Vitro Gen Bioservices. That gave me a fantastic opportunity to work with and set up the lab and also the global team for 5 years. We had built the team, and then in fact from the collaboration we also published in a journal, science journal, from the Joe Ecker lab, some of the works what we had done here. Yeah. So later
yeah, hi Gopi.
Certain places. But there was a call from some official scientific. They were looking for a profile, something like me. And then I accepted the offer, and then that's where my commercial side came into picture. So I moved as a technical commercial manager there. So I was managing the Cellomics, the enzymes and product lines in their company. So that's where the sometimes. See, when you go to the commercial side, you'll be able to understand the importance of technical capabilities. I was there 18 months there, so the genetic call came to take up as a business head completely there. Still, I was considered as a techno-commercial role there. We always have to depend on the US for certain decisions. I thought moving to an Indian company would be much more, like I can take the call immediately. That's what I was thinking. So, because a lot of the times, in the US companies, you need to wait for the, there are protocols you need to wait for certain decisions to make. So I was kind of always wanted to make big decisions. It was not so easy inside the US companies. So that's where I took the opportunity to work at a genotypic as a business and then work for 5 years. And then I was responsible for sales and marketing. So all these companies gave me the view of like what it should be like as a company, it should look like. So MNC companies have certain good things, Indian companies have certain good things. So all these things, if you use it, you can build a better company always. So it's not something like one company is better than the other. So there are systems are different, processes are different in each places. So the decisions will always take more time than MNC companies. So that was always itching me last like 10-12 years of experience having that. Always taking the salary is one thing, and then what is that you can do back to society? So that is another thing which I started asking when I was in genotypic, like 3rd year or 4th year. I had already resigned 1 year before I left the company. That's how the relationship was with the genotypic. So my main aim was, okay, whatever I have learned, how do I keep back in the society? So it's not something like we have 1 course or 2 pieces, but somehow we can contribute back to the societies, building companies and building product lines in India, so that we don't have to depend on the West all the time. So that is one of the reasons the whole company started. So the main aim of the company, vision of the company is imagine, innovate and impact. So basically imagine to innovate and then innovate to impact. So whatever you are trying to do, just to have some impact at the end of the day. So that's what we are trying to do. What you can see in the picture is, in fact, my professor Uday Kumar, who is kind of one of my role models, and my father, who inaugurating the company at that point. So it's a 3.5 years before we started this company, and then just we are kind of a, you could say it's a baby step. We are kind of self-reliant at this point, but there's a lot of things we can do this company. So as earlier I mentioned, since I have worked in the genomics, I knew that genomics information is exploding, but how do you apply that to the precision medicine? That's where we were looking at. We decided we will work with the Biostation Genomics and Precision Medicine Research and as well as the companies where we can contribute to a better extent. So when I was looking for the technology partners, since many companies had sequencing as a major thing, but there was a gap between the sequencing information of the RNA expression, whatever you do with the RNA-seq, to the actual application. So translation assays have to be developed, and then that's where we thought the NanoString could be playing a bigger role. So we were the first company to buy the NanoString encounter, and then started providing the services and solutions. And then last 3 years, we have run almost like 2,000 plus samples, and then we have kind of learned quite a bit using this, and then we are working with many companies to develop certain signatures and also the researchers to develop signatures. So our lab is around 2,800 square feet. We are the kind of first company, and then we are a small team, around 7 to 8 people at this point, but a lot of fun and energetic team to handle the projects. As earlier I mentioned, 2,000 samples. This is the team, Terracuse. There is a new joining who I have added it later. So it's last 1.5 year before. There are a couple of people, changes are there. Bindu is my wife, and it's one of the functions we have taken. Antima has moved out to IIM Lucknow now. So there are 7 to 8 people we are at this point in the company. So just I will explain what I have learned as an entrepreneur, and then Vikki Ashok can take it forward. So we are quite choosy in selecting the partners. So because partner is like a marriage, so it's not so easy to have marriage with everyone. So you have to spend time with them and then work with them. So that's one of the reason NanoString is kind of be working very closely, and also recently we have selected Rosalind as a partner. So for all these things, financial support has come from the family. So it's quite a bit of a struggle. It's not so easy to, because when you start, when a lot of the times you think it is easy to start a company. As a one person you can start, but if you have to invest a couple of crores and then bank is not ready to give you the loan, it becomes a huge challenge. And then I'll tell you a couple of incidences of what happened exactly. So that basically family, friends, customers are helping us quite a bit. Because once you create the services, that recurring customers, that's what is going to help us to build the company. So whatever I said was as a kind of a initiated, how I initiated. There are certain lessons I have learned so far. So some 2-3 lessons, just I'll tell you the anecdotes for that. So it's a fantastic thing if you look at it. When I was starting the company, I thought, okay, I know 3,000 people in LinkedIn at that point. I know 3,000 people. At least 30 people I know closely. Each one, if they believe me, and then if they put 10 lakh rupees, I can raise 3-4 rupees to start the company. So that was my logic. But it was not so easy to even to generate 50-60 lakh rupees. So it's we wanted around 1.5 crore rupees to start this company. So it's to raise around 70-75 lakh rupees myself and my family had put, and then to raise another 75 lakh rupees, I have to struggle almost 2-3 months. So what I believe is, a lot of people talk when it comes to, they will say they will help us and all those things, but as soon as the money comes into the picture, it is difficult for many to partner. So it's that's one thing. Core is wants to start the company, so just be careful when somebody says they will give, and then they can always come back and say they have another problem, because we will never know their internal issues. Somebody might be earning X or Y lakh rupees for a month, but they will always have X or Y lakh rupees spending already kind of aligned to that, and they have to arrange for that. So you can't blame anyone. So it's always difficult for people to part with money to part. So another thing I learned is, if you are in trouble, ask for help. So it comes to you from other sources. It's a very interesting thing. So it's a paradox, a lot of times, isn't it? So many people who say that they will give the money, they will say, I have this, I have that, I have that. But when you ask certain people whom they believe you, so they will help you, and also they will tell their friends to help you. So that's one thing which a friend of mine, after 10 years of his kind of after undergrad here, he was in the army, and just we were talking, he said he wants to invest some money. Here is a company which he believed in me, and then he and his wife invested, and then he told his friends, and then they invested in my company. So it's always be open to people. So don't expect anything. If they help you, that is the best thing to do. So that's what I understand. You should always ask for the help, and it comes to you from unknown source. So today, they have invested debt investment as well as the equity investment some of his friends. So there is always money there with the people, but they have to have a reliable source. That's how they work. So another thing I learned is your experience is your limitation. A lot of the times we know that sometimes we believe, okay, I know so much, I have so much of 15 years of experience or 20 years of experience. That could be your limitation also. With the experience, you get wiser, but you don't try certain things which you have not done earlier. So it's like touching the fire, isn't it? So it's if you know what exactly the fire, you get scared. Whatever the red thing is there, you get scared to touch. But if you don't know, you are open to try certain things. That's what happened with these entrepreneurs. Larry Page and Sergey Brin, Bill Gates, all these people were very young during when they started the companies. So they didn't have much experience. They had kind of raw things. Things were set for them to deep dive into the thing. They didn't have anything to lose if you look at it. Once you earn something or once you have experience, you always get scared to lose certain things. So, if there are youngsters who are in the audience, if at all if you have idea and if you want to start, don't wait for after 20 years of I will earn money and everything and start. So don't wait for that. If you have an idea, you go ahead and start. So there is no way you can get all the money for everything, all the time for any company to start. So it's very, very difficult. A lot of the times, there are some cases are there where KFC and other things started around when they were 65 years. And there are also success stories out there. On an average, they say 40 plus is the kind of average. But there are, if at all, if you want to build a reckless company or the phenomenal company, only when you are young you can do that. That's what I think is possible. Because a lot of the times we are scared of certain things, and then we are scared to take loan, we are scared to do certain things as you grow older. So that's the kind of three learnings I had from being an entrepreneur so far. So just to end a couple of things, to do whatever I'm doing, my role models are like my grandfather, who taught me the joy of reading, because that helped me quite a bit. Because even if you don't have any friends, books could be your friend, so library could be your friend. So it's a fantastic thing to do. You can imagine the next time reading what you want. That helped me to go through an undergrad education. There used to be a lot of holidays we enjoyed. Staying in the, not going to my native, just staying in the library and then doing. So in fact, my parents who taught me another role models, like my parents taught me meaning of sacrifice. One of the times they used to save money for education, so that's being a lower middle class family. I really appreciate their sacrifice, whatever they have done for me as well. And I'm lucky we were four people in the home. I was kind of a middle person. And then I could go anywhere I want. And so my brother, elder brother and younger brother and sister are there in the family. So it's kind of a, they have sacrificed quite a bit for me during the phase of my life. So. And then my teacher, he's Professor Uday Kumar, who was my MSc and then PhD kind of a co-guide, who taught me the meaning of perseverance. So he's the one who inaugurated our company also. So if you look at it, there is always, he always said, we all used to get enraged by the system, but he always said, if you just go out of the system, you can't do anything. Yeah, just leave the system and try to change the system. So that's rather than just getting out of the system and doing nothing. So you have to be rebel, but you understand the system and try to change the system. So that's how he believes. And then he always got so much funding from the organization and then built a fantastic lab with probably 50, 60 PhDs out of the top result department. So, another person who inspired me to become an entrepreneur is again Steve Jobs. So, see, if you look at his deep thinking to produce the products and to make sure that people have the feeling for certain things, he's really a marketing genius who created out of nowhere certain products which many people really didn't think of. So these are the people whom I think I'm looking up always to become. Contribute something to the world. So the philosophy I believe in, so this is a book, probably many, there might be a lot of developmental biologists here. They might know Scott Gilbert. Again, he is from Harvard, I think. He and his brothers both are science scientists, Scott F. Gilbert and David Gilbert. There are two people around. So, in his book, he says, you are just a cell, because we were all, at the end of the day, we were just a cell before being born, isn't it? Either a sperm and an egg, they joined to become a cell. It could have died at any point, but we all became a human being whether there is a sorrow or happiness, whatever you experience during that time, it's all profit for life. That's what he says in his book. I don't remember exactly who is the author, but that's the reason I put it on, because I'm not able to get the book back again. So it's a kind of early book which I read on the developmental biology during my early stages of the undergrad lives. So the last and the least, as earlier I mentioned, my philosophy, whatever I believe, even if I lose all the wealth I have earned, I need is the family. So it's not something which, because I always believe in whatever you have earned, you can lose, but you can't get back at all if you lose your family. So it's, many of the times when we are going through the rough time during research, there's only place where you go all the time is to family and then your wife and kid, whatever it is, your immediate family, they take care of you. So that's very, very important. Being an entrepreneur, it's sometimes it's very tough. So my wife has helped me quite a bit during that time. So that's, she also works in the Bayer, so that helps me quite a bit. So that helps to be an entrepreneur. So. Thank you, and then happy to serve us with Prash.
What an awesome presentation, Gopi. Thank you so much. It's an awe-inspiring presentation. In fact, my respect towards you is quadruple now. Not that I haven't had those kind of respects through our wonderful LinkedIn exchanges. This is absolutely incredible, and I'm sure from at least 28 people attending live here and about 25-30 watching from YouTube, there are at least six bioinformatics for school children who are less than 13 or 14 years old. And after your talk, I'm sure they would start respecting entrepreneurship, biology, and bioinformatics, in the way that you have gone through these leaps and bounds.
I think that's what youngsters, I always feel, as we've been 30 years younger to now, so sometimes.
I don't know, it might be good or bad, so just keeping in view of this, Gopi, a very first question to you is, you were doing a PhD in plant stress biology, and you have moved towards your entrepreneurial journey, more towards molecular life sciences, especially in the human genomics and other areas. So what was going through your mind when you finished your PhD?
Did you ever think of putting yourself towards your entrepreneurial journey?
No. In fact, that's an interesting question. So, if you look at it, every person who is doing PhD, they think they are going to win Nobel Prize, isn't it? So they want to win the Nobel Prize. So it's if you look at when I was doing my PhD, so it's stress biology, plant stress biology. I was looking as a molecular, I'm trying to learn the molecular biology, that's all I was looking at it, because I was interested in the molecular biology. I was never interested in X or Y, because my interest was to look at the, as earlier I mentioned, there was a RDRP enzyme had written a hypothesis which kind of had led to me to go and do something in that RDRP enzyme, especially, because it was in the RNA mechanism. So I always wanted to be in the academic side. So I never wanted to be in industry, if you look at it. But when you start doing the things, so as earlier I mentioned, I'm a more of a thought scientist rather than the kind of a experimental scientist. So there is a rat race in the academic world where you have to keep on publishing and then do certain things where then only you will get an assistant professor, associate professor, and then your life will be only to do certain things to certain area of the research, isn't it? But I was never kind of that kind of guy because I wanted to experience multiple things. So that's where I had moved from one side to another side. And then when I got an opportunity to work as a, because I was setting myself, okay, 30 plus years you need to be independent, like 35 years or something, you need to have your own team. So I got an opportunity to do those things even in industry. So that's where I took that as an opportunity and did whatever I wanted to do. So in the industry, if you look at it, the money is not a criteria. So it's in a sense, if you put the plan properly, people are going to fund you to develop the team and then do certain things. But there will be a limited space what you can do in the industry, but not in academia. Academia today you can do something one area and then tomorrow you can change entirely a different area. But you have to stick to the organization thing, and then there will be certain resistance always. But I was never scared of certain things moving to another area. Because I always feel, even I'll tell even family or somewhere, when I got married, I was kind of I was still under fellowship. So I was earning around 5,600 rupees because it turned from CSR fellowship 2,800 to 5,600 rupees they changed. And then my wife joined a little bit earlier than me as a job. So it is, I think a lot of the people nowadays, younger people, they feel insecure on certain things. But I feel if you have certain goal, you should not really worry of money at that point. So you can always change the things. And good thing in US, and then the thing is, they really don't care what your background is. You can always do whatever you want.
Excellent, Gopi. So if you really look back, Gopi, the RDRP article in Current Science, you believe it or not, it was in 2002, when I was in CCMB, I was still doing my master's. We used to have a journal club over there, and my mentor then Kirish Tiwari, we're all a part of Lalji Singh's group, he told us this particular article. Now I recall, once you put up this.
And then I faintly remember, because
when we were also discussing this particular aspect a couple of years ago, on some other things. I mean, believe it or not, Current Science was almost, you know, a kind of a part of a journal club activity at that point of time. We used to read the edit page, the editorial, and some perspective articles, short sub articles from the absolute feature. They were all in print at that point of time, and there were at least a dozen copies of Current Science that were put up in CCM. Where we used to have, you know, weekly Current Science articles on red.
Deepankar Patran Chatterjee was from CCMB, isn't it?
Right.
He wrote in that article, in this issue, about my article in that journal. So probably he was also, he reviewed, I think, at the end of the day. So,
the scientific part of this particular, my point is, amazingly, know your thought on RDRP when compared to RDDP is quite, you know, stimulative, keeping in view of, you know, the tomato genetics. Because, you know, I remember 2 decades ago, tomato and potato, they were believed to be a part of, you know, one, you know, big, you know, genera. They also thought that the genetic zone underlying this particular enzymatic activity, you know, was also incongruent, you know, with respect to all the other plant species. So can you tell us a little bit about what transpired to write this wonderful article, as a pretty early career researcher, probably you just finished your PhD then?
No. In fact, I was an undergrad when I wrote that.
But it took five years
for me to publish that because there was no RNA mechanism. I had to go back to them saying that, okay, look at the RNA mechanism is there. In the plant, it is present. It should be there even in the animals. Why not? So that's all. Because people have not discovered it doesn't mean that it is not there, isn't it? So I was looking at, if you look at RNA amplification can happen without any problem, isn't it? Why do you need to have a transcription every time? Go back and then redo the things, because DNA is a single copy. If you look at in a cell, RNA could be 1,000 or 10,000 copies. if you want to multiply, use RNA rather than DNA. See, especially in the globin production and all, certain times, even in the certain hormones will spike in such a way that you will have millions of copies of certain RNAs in certain cases. Especially in the when the sperm enters the egg, certain changes will happen phenomenally. So it's a lot of the times it's a post-transceptual regulation. That's what people know that. But how exactly it happens, there are certain anecdotal proofs are there. But I'm not followed afterwards. There are sometimes when people find certain things about the RDRP. My friends just forward me. But since I'm not in that kind of a academic mind now, so I don't go through the completely. But it looks like there should be some activity which can kind of amplify the signal. That I was looking at RDRP as an amplification of signals.
Wonderful. So moving forward, Gopi, how did you know COVID change your entrepreneurial journey? Did it really affect, or how did this?
In fact, see, if you look at, I always say that when technical people, why they can't sell easily, because their mindset have to be changed. I'm not telling that they can't sell, because I was also technical, because you have to change the things in your mind to sell. To sell, you have to be shameless, isn't it? A lot of the times you have to knock the door of a scientist. You have to become dumb sometimes and then do certain things which a lot of the times you should forget you are a kind of a, you know, science, or you know certain things. See, when I started the company, we were thinking of doing the high-end things, and then COVID kind of opened up certain things which I had never thought of stuff, if you look at it. We are working with certain manufacturers now, so we are kind of acting as a, see, there was a situation where monthly salary is very difficult to pay because there are not many projects. Though people had said they will give the project, but they didn't know, there was a lot of uncertainty, they were not getting the funding. So we started selling certain reagents, certain consumables, because our team also helped me to work with in that direction. So people should be ready to do certain things. Once you are kind of deep in the water, you should not worry what is the kind of thing, isn't it? So it's just, we started selling certain items which kind of increase the revenue for us, and then somehow we have sustained for last year without much problem. Then probably another 1 year we may have to face this, but at least now the projects are coming up much better than earlier.
Gopi, as always. Something on the lines of COVID.
Also, I want to add this couple of, see, during the COVID time only we worked with Rosalind to sign up with the MOU with them. We're going to launch that analysis in India soon. And also, there are opportunities, many medical and health companies we have kind of signed up now to work with them, because now they understood the importance of nanostring and other things. There we'll be working with them closely. It opened up quite a bit, because many companies earlier they were in nutshell, now they are open to work with multiple companies, so that's a good thing.
Wonderful, Gopi. Ever since this COVID picture has come last year, many frontline therapies were trying to be attempted, but in vain. Many frontline therapies, even the plasma intervention therapy, is really called up now, even by ICMR and even the CDC. You know, at least in the developing countries where the vaccine is still in infancy. But you know, as someone who is an expert in RNA interference, could you see RNA interference regulated frontline therapy coming up for COVID?
Yes, there was a news sometime. I don't remember whether it is Germany or some other company from Germany or some other country. They had put up a kind of a trial for that. That's what I remember. There is. And also people are looking at inhibitor for the RDRP, so that is another thing which from the COVID thing, if you look at it. So I know the there was a news crush, but I can't remember which company it is.
Right.
There was an
Right.
I mean, even if we were to attend that, Gopi, sorry to extend this conversation.
Keeping in view of the receptors, the TMPRSS2, and the wiring integration, taking place, could we, leveraging RNA interference, the LVG leveraging RNA interference, not to the best, even though the receptors in activation is not so that stringent in the host, I mean, even if it were to be, how challenging it is, from a scientific point of view. Yeah, so if you look at RNA interference has been successful in certain diseases, especially when the especially the ocular degeneration, I think that is where it is, where they can apply easily. So I'm not sure if you want to give it in the blood or if you want to inject, how we are going to be targeted in certain places, unless you have a targeted mechanism of certain, let's say the lung cells, if you can you use certain receptors to kill the COVID RNA. That is another approach people have to take. But I don't know what is the approach this company is taking, but it could be a challenging, that's what I feel. It's not so easy as a topical application which you can do on the outside.
Right, thank you, Gopi, on that.
So moving further, Gopi, I mean, over the last several years, you have really introduced nanostring and 360 degrees and single cell transcriptome technologies towards Indian diaspora, scientific diaspora. With respect to we Indian scientists, I still feel that we are at least two or three years behind the developments that are really taking place in the US in terms of taking up the single cell transcriptomics, taking the validated entries from the bulk scene, and taking it in offer requirements, and taking these particular results towards precision therapies. So where do you see this particular growth in a post-COVID picking up? I mean, do you think that we are still in infancy, or do you think that there is a life in this?
Yeah, sure. See, the challenge in India is pharma companies have to put, especially cancer-connected thing, if you look at it, they have to put a lot of money in the R&D, isn't it? So it's, for example, let's say that BMS, they have Indian unit here, but majority of the things also done in US. So it's all the single cell transcriptome and all those things are done outside. So again, academia, see, industry and academia, if they collaborate very well, that's where we can see some of these technologies could be used extensively. That's what I feel, which is not so easily happening in India. So at least the post-COVID, I think the pharma companies are going to have more money now. I hope they will put more money in the R&D, especially in the in terms of the where precision genomics and other things is needed. See, again, we also understood coronavirus or COVID virus, since we didn't sequence very much in the beginning, there was a delay in identifying certain variants and other stuff. So it could have been much earlier. We could have sequenced a lot of these things. Again, it's all in the our mindset. We have to somehow the we are always depending on the government to do it. A lot of the times, pharma companies should come out with and then plan for R&D extensively. Only if they have money, they will put so much money in the R&D. But outside, they put billions of dollars to certain times in the R&D. So I think we should collaborate with pharma companies to do these things. That's what I feel. Companies like Origin and all those things, they're doing really, at least they're know these technologies and then they apply these technologies very well. But not everyone does that. So that's, this is a challenge we have.
Wonderful. So moving further, Gopi, if you really look back, at least a decade ago, not much is known about understanding the non-coding RNAs, taking into picture the protein complexes, you know, that are probably regulating these non-coding RNAs like microRNAs and all this stuff.
But we have got a whole bunch of
non-coding RNAs.
Largely the long non-coding RNAs, which I personally have that particular discussion with you.
And of course, we have got a new sect of long non-coding RNAs, like the long non-coding RNAs, the pvRNAs, and all those kind of stuff. If we are asked to validate these so-called non-coding RNAs, keeping in view of the protein complex format, in terms of understanding towards regulation,
how
tangible it is to use technologies like NanoString?
See, the if you look at, so are you looking at the protein complex or the, are you looking for the RNA-RNA interaction?
RNA
interaction with the protein, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting question if you look at it. In my postdoctoral studies, that's what I was trying to set up in using the, what do you call the radioactive assays. We were putting the miRNA in the cellular lysate and then look at where it is going, at which protein it is interacting, which RNA it is interacting. That's how we used to do. Again, if you know which antibodies, which see the NanoString, the challenge here is it is not a discovery tool. It is a tool which, if you already know which complexes are there, which proteins are there, you can, if you have the antibodies for that, you can do the multiplex assays using the NanoString. It's not a problem because you can pull down studies you can do using the labeled miRNA, labeled RNA, or interacting RNAs you can pull down. Then look for those expression patterns, RNA as well as the protein in the NanoString, because that can allow to do both RNA and protein expression studies. But you should know what RNA you are looking for. If you are looking for a discovery mode, I would suggest RNA-seq approach should be the best approach, and then also the MALDI or the protein sequencing would be another approach you can take it forward. But if you are looking for already known thing, we would recommend NanoString to do it. You can see it's a good thing you can create a panel which is reproducibly results could be given. You have to do the pull down studies and then look for what kind of interactions are there.
Perfect, Gopi. Gopi, I know from your wonderful presentation, from the people you got inspired, right from Professor Day and Professor Slack, and all those wonderful people. You always try to put collaborations first, to collaborate, not to compete. But as an entrepreneur, it is suddenly a kind of a challenge for you, from an entrepreneurial perspective, competition plays a very important role. And in this particular process, you might really come up in a lot of disagreements, probably with many of your senior colleagues or with your junior colleagues and all those kind of people. Can you probably narrate one such incident where you try to disagree in an agreeable way, because this is a common most question where I ask all my guests, because the young generation especially, the mentor-mentee relationships are absolutely in a dilemma, because either way people do not know how to disagree. So thank you.
It's a very interesting question. So it's if you look at it, we are all humans who have our own, as earlier I mentioned, we are limited by our experience, isn't it? So if I say that, okay, this is the way only it has to be done, then it's a challenge. So I can always say that this is one of the ways. Can you do better way, or can you follow this? So this is how I look at it when I'm working with my team. So I ask them first to do the research, come back to me. If they don't find anything better than that, then they can use this. So it's not something we have. A lot of the times we are also we don't read much. As you grow old, you end up telling whatever we know. That's also that's one thing our Professor Uday Kumar used to do with us is he used to give us the paper, and since he didn't have time to read the paper, he will tell us, okay, can you just have a presentation, can you go through this and then come back to me with the thing. So we used to help him to prepare the presentation. So he used to learn from us, so it's indirectly we both are learning with each other. So that's how, because though I'm an entrepreneur, still I'm a kind of a learning person. But also I know that my limitations. So because a lot of the times our team might be reading much more than me or my colleagues. In fact, in Genotypic, I used to take care of the business, and then my colleague used to take care of the technical side. He used to be my advisor all the time, isn't it? So I have to go and then ask him, can you help me with this? Can you? Because if I start reading, I'm not going to be better than him. So all of us should know that what is our strength and then what is our weakness. We should work with their strength and then work with them and then make sure that we get the best out of them. I would call all the time. I would be the dumbest person in the room so that I can learn more in the oral interaction rather than me giving gyan all the time. So I would be happy to hear from the others, but sometimes obviously egos are there, because this is one of the challenge with people who are technical. So sometimes I believe, should I have done, if I had not done the technical, would I have done business better? So because a lot of times your technical mind just comes into the picture, you start thinking certain things, but you have to be, a lot of the times you have to be dumb at certain point, because you should leave others to talk. So that's how I look at it. And I would rather take that as a complimentary for my work, take some input from the others and then better it at my place. So see, as a company, you need a lot of advisors. At the end of the day, you might be playing the game, but you need advisors because they are experts. That's how I look at it.
Amazing, Gopi. Final couple of questions, Gopi, will not take much of your time. Gopi, imagine we are you are given 100 million US dollar funding, to establish a kind of a wonderful center for excellence where your company is a part of it, where you yourself is a director for that. What would be your take, given the current post-COVID pandemic,
and what would be the best technology
where you can probably take this up
so that you can ensure
that your mentees would probably take inspiration from you,
from the wonderful entrepreneurial journey that you have surpassed
over the last 2 decades.
How do you see that this is evolving?
Please.
Yeah, please. Thank you.
I believe the genome sequencing is one thing which we need to be aggressively doing. If you look at it, Grail is the company, isn't it? That's the one which Illumina recently bought, that company. Before they started, in fact, I was thinking of a similar idea here. So, can we sequence the million genomes and then look at it? What is that we have separate from others? So it's, or can we get into a model where you sequence million genomes at the cost itself, where people can come back and then look at it if they need. So for example, there might be rare diseases, certain things we are not able to identify, certain things. So It's important to have certain information, and also the Center for Informatics, if you look at it, we are still depending on outside, whatever certain facilities and all those things. It would be a great thing to set up a kind of a genomic center where people can pay $100 or $200 and then get their sequence, the genome sequence, and then that could be done, used for the research. And then the same thing could be used for their, in the future, certain their disease progression or something. If it is happening, they can always be alarmed. So that could be one center I would think of setting up in case if the money is given.
Excellent, Gopi.
We have a few questions from the audience, but I'll just try to sum up and pile it up into one because you have answered at least one or two of them directly. Sugu, our secretary of BioClues, and Varka, who is a postdoc at University of Rajasthan with Professor Lohia, and Aarti, they have these questions. So, what if, you know, what would be the entrepreneurial take from a student? How should he start financing? That would be one of the questions. And if that were the case, how difficult it is, to pick it up in an industry or to make it more entrepreneurial? And is there a role of an incubation center, taking up as a part of this particular entrepreneurial journey? Yeah, please. Thank you.
In fact, if you are a student, I think that would be the best thing to do if you look at it. But think of something which is just not what others are doing. So other than that, you can always look at something unique, because people are looking at funding for incubation centers, especially they encourage students to get into the entrepreneurial thing rather than just the scientists coming up, and then they use the fund for again the same type of research. So I would rather say that even if you have, you can always talk to your parents or the friends, brainstorm the ideas. Don't get scared of people will steal away the ideas. So that's, people say there is a dozens of ideas for a penny. So it's, ideas are different, executions are different. So many people might say, okay, my ideas will be stolen and all this. That's all. I don't believe in that. There could be, see, Amazon, everybody knows Amazon, isn't it? It is not so easy to create certain things. Execution is the key thing everywhere. If you have confidence, if you know this is, I'm kind of absolutely sure, or I can use people's strength to do that. Sometimes you might not have all the strength. If you know how to get the work done from others, you can talk to the people and then you see whether you have some co-founders or something. So then you can always mitigate the risk and then start. But again, you need to have clear thought of what is your role or what is her role or what is his role. Because a lot of the times, without very loosely, people will start certain things and then they will end up in fight, and then things will not move as expected. So people have to be clear, okay, I'm going to take care of this role, you are going to take care of that role. But if there are differences, we will talk and then work out. So there are books from the Google How It Started. Maybe you should read that. There are plenty of books for the entrepreneurial stuff. But I have read, I can always suggest in case you can come back and then ask me. Some of the books I have not kept the book down and then read, so it's very interesting books. I always felt Google is the best company to start. If you look at it, they had idea, somebody wanted to write the check, they didn't have the bank account to take the check. So it's basically when they took the check and then created the bank account. So, it's your idea is important, but don't try to start simply telling that I'm going to do the service similar to other things, because that will not give you the leeway on certain things unless you have certain strength in doing that or building the steps.
Yeah, excellent, Gopi. I think that's it from me. Before I say final words, do you have any final say, Gopi?
Sure. First of all, thanks for organizing this crash. So when you asked me, I didn't know what to talk, because I thought a lot of the time when you talk of